casting rigid foam into silicone molds. In this tutorial, we're going to go over some steps for creating nice, well-skinned foam parts with a nice clean back, so minimal cleanup is needed for finished parts. Now, to begin with, we'll be casting into a silicone mold. For this, we'll be using a mold we made in a previous video. This is a PlatSeal gel tin silicone mold, so no release is necessary. Now, in some cases, you might want to dust the surface of the mold with baby powder, as you saw us do in a previous video. That gets you a nice matte surface that makes it much easier to paint later on. And the ideal working temperature for foam is going to be around 75 to 85 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, to begin, one thing that's really important to understand about expanding foams is the way they're measured. Rigid foams, flexible foams, are measured by their density per cubic foot. So, for instance, if we have a cubic foot, 6-pound density foam means that it expands to 6 pounds per cubic foot in free rise. That means very little or any restriction. So, if we were to mix up a 6-pound batch of foam, that would expand to fill a cubic foot. Now again, this is not precise because as soon as you put that into a mold that has any kind of restriction on it, that's going to change some of that geometry a little bit and create maybe a bottleneck effect in some molds that may lower that yield. And if it's highly compressed, it may actually drop down to more of a 5-pound density or 4.5-pound density foam. But that's how foams are measured. So when you get a 6-pound density foam like our rigid casting foam, that means that will expand in free rise to 6 pounds per cubic foot. Now, as I mentioned earlier, foam likes warm temperatures. A warm shop environment is going to create a better skin. So we're warming up the inside of our mold with a heat lamp and preparing that for our casting process. Now, the first thing we need to do is cast a test part. And this is one of those things that's, I can't stress this enough. If you're doing any kind of manufacturing or any kind of production run where you're going to be doing a lot of parts that are the same, your first part is really a part that's just to learn the mold. This is not going to be a part that you could use for production necessarily unless you get extremely lucky. This is more of a chance to learn the mold and learn the way the mold is going to behave with this particular foam formula. And since we've never cast foam into this mold before, we don't know exactly what the volume is. So I'm going to mix up a 6-ounce batch, which is probably more than we need, but I'd rather have more than not enough. If we need enough that it's actually coming out of the mold, as you'll see later. Now, you can, if you're on a tight budget and you're working with a really large mold, you can also do this in several batches. And those batches will stick to each other. Foam is incredibly adhesive, so you don't have to worry about batches separating from each other, but you may see a discernible line where those batches went together. So make sure if you're doing a large mold, you might need to pour that in stages until you fill it up. Or you could do a small mold like we're doing here. You could just mix up a batch that might be a little bit more than you need. So you might have a little bit of waste on this first cast, but again, that's okay because that's part of learning the mold. And once we get that sloshed around to make sure we get this in all the little areas of the mold that are kind of tricky to get to, like the ears and the jaw, we're going to let that free rise out of the mold. And this particular foam, this is our rigid casting foam, and it has kind of a long cream time. So when you mix it up, it'll be in that kind of a gel state for a little bit where you could slosh it around, and then all of a sudden it's like someone throws a switch and it starts expanding. So as soon as it does that, you need to leave it alone, let it rise, and as you see here, it will expand out of the back of the mold, and we want to just let it do that on this first cast. Now, again, the important thing with rigid foams or flexible foams is even though the foam is expanding, the weight stays the same. And that's what we're going to exploit here for this particular process, is since we know that weight is constant, what we're going to do is now that we have a foam part, and obviously we have a little bit more creating that little mushroom out the back of the head, we can remove that excess, and what's left over will tell us exactly how much foam we need to fill that mold. Now, we could just keep casting a little bit extra in the mold each time and wind up with a part like this that we could just trim off that excess foam and call that done. But the downside to that is if we're just letting that free rise each time, you'll find that you don't get as nice of a skin surface on a part like that. So what we want to do is calculate exactly how much foam we're going to need per cast and then be able to restrict that rise just a little bit so we get a nicer, cleaner skin and a more polished part when we pull that out of the mold, as you'll see here in a minute. So what I'm doing here is just using a regular wood saw to just cut off any of that excess foam. And once we've removed that, we can weigh that and see exactly what our foam volume needs to be. Now this, again, this is where things get a little tricky to explain because we're using a volume measured foam. This foam is measured one-to-one by volume, and here we're getting a weight measurement. So we're going to have to do a little bit of finessing here to get the number where we want it to be. Now remember, we started out with 3 ounces of A and 3 ounces of B by volume. Now again, this is we're weighing it here, and the foam is a little bit more dense than water in its liquid components. So we're getting kind of a rough estimate here. It's not going to be surgically precise here, but once we trim off any of that excess, that will reduce that 6 ounces down to, in this case, it's going to wind up being around 4 ounces of liquid foam that we're going to wind up needing once we've trimmed away that excess. And the idea here is we want to calculate it so we have just enough foam to fill the mold and exceed just a little bit out of the top of the mold, so that if we cap off that mold, we'll wind up with a little bit of back pressure. We don't want too much. We obviously don't want to distort the mold or warp the mold. Now, to do that, to cap off the mold, we're going to use a piece of plastic. This is just a scrap piece of Lexan we had in our shop, and I'm waxing that up, and it has a hole drilled in it in the middle to vent out the excess air as this expands. Now, you could also use a piece of waxed plywood. Here, I'm just waxing this with some of the Pardol high-temp wax. And the reason I'm using that high-temp wax is that's better suited for materials that have a high exotherm. It put off a lot of heat. And that just ensures that when that foam exotherms, that doesn't just push right through that wax. So now we're ready to mix up our new batch. Now we're going to do 2 ounces by volume of A and 2 ounces of volume of B. And that's going to give us around a 4 ounce batch. And you'll notice I've got that hot light on the mold preparing it. And that's just to get the temperature of the mold up exactly where we need it. We want that to be pretty warm because remember, a cold mold is going to give you a less expansion and a less uniform skin. So the warmer you can get that mold, the better quality parts you're going to have. Sometimes you'll see that by accident when you're casting a lot of parts. After you cast the first part, the exotherm of that part warms up the mold, and then additional casts will be better just by default. But if you can introduce heat to that mold first, that'll make sure that you don't have any bad casts, any bad surface issues from cold molds. And now ready to pour our foam. And with a small batch like this, you want to be as precise as possible because, and remember, anytime you're working in small batches, you want to be real careful about mix ratio because even one-to-one mix materials that are fairly forgiving, when you're working in small amounts, that margin of error is really tight. So be as accurate as possible. And you'll notice there, as soon as I stir everything up, I'm scraping everything I can get out of that mixing cup. And the reason for that is since I calculated that at about 4 ounces, I want to make sure I get every bit of that material into that mold. And once I've sloshed that around, I'm ready to cap off the mold. And the reason I'm sloshing this around is this is a somewhat complicated shape. And if I were to just cap it off, I might wind up with some voids in the mold because as that foam expands, it might bypass some of those areas and leave voids in, say, the teeth or the jaw of that lion. So I sloshed it around a little bit, then capped it off, and now I'm putting a 25-pound weight on the back. And that just ensures that everything stays flush through the casting process. You know, in a perfect world, we'd actually strap that and really close it tight, but that weight worked just fine. And you see now we had just barely a little bit of foam pushing up against the plastic, just enough to create a nice, clean, flat back. And now this is where you really see a difference in the quality of casting. Just adding a little bit of back pressure here, you see that we get a much cleaner skin surface on that foam. That back pressure really gives us a nice skin surface and a much more uniform cast. And now, after this point, you can play around with how much foam you're mixing up. You could even raise that amount ever so slightly to get a little bit more compression inside that mold. And obviously there's a point of diminishing returns there. If you mix up way too much foam, you will get a lot of compression, but it'll be a very bad compression that will distort the mold and possibly even distort the part from the foam kind of imploding on itself. But there you have the process of casting foam with a nice clean back. And you can see there the difference. It's going to be very minimal cleanup work now on this lion's head when we pull it out with that backing. And also you see up close here, the first cast, you can see that the cell structure on that foam is not near as nice and uniform as the one that had the back pressure. And there you have the basic process of casting rigid casting foam into a silicone mold. And as always, all the products are available on our web store at brickintheyard.com. And if you check the video description, we have links to all of the products we used right there. So be sure to check out those links. And on the left-hand side, if you haven't already, be sure to like and subscribe. And be sure to click that bell icon so you get notified anytime we create new content. And on the right-hand side, I'm going to put a link to that gel tin video, the video where we actually made that lion's head mold. So be sure to check that out. That'll be right up there, right there on the right-hand side. Thanks again for watching.